Praise the Lord. We welcome you to the broadcast ministries of Victory Apostolic Church, where Elder Andrew D. Singleton, Jr. is the senior pastor. At Victory, we are committed to building victorious Christ-like lives through the worshiping and glorifying of God to transform the lives of all we minister to.
So I'd like you to follow me and those sharing on television, Matthew chapter 6, verses 1 through 8. Be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of others to be seen by them. If you do, you will have no reward from your Father in heaven. So when you give to the needy, don't announce it with trumpets, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and on the streets, to be what? Honored by others. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you give to the needy, don't let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. And when you pray, don't be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you pray, I said, when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then this unseen Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. And when you pray, don't keep on babbling like pagans, for they think they'll be heard because they have many words. Don't be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. And all of God's people said, amen. And my subject is get along to get along with God. It's hard to imagine anything wrong with a person giving to others and praying to their God. What Jesus is teaching is that it is not enough to do good. Good must be done with right motives that are acceptable to God. In other words, why we do what we do is important. Rough message already. Sisters, you know, it's like the guy that asks you out and spends a lot of money on you, and he says he just wants to show you a good time. But then afterwards, he feels he has not received his reward. Ah, now I got them. See, you got to just always go down that road to get people. You see, that's a person who may be doing something that's nice, taking you to dinner, but there's a bad motive. And most of us are cautious of people. Well, that has a huge thing to do with trusting people is, you know, why are you doing this? Why are you helping me? What's your motive? So we all know ultimately in life, motivation is critical. Look at your neighbor now that you have it and say, why you do what you do is important. Hallelujah. You see, Jesus says it's the hypocrite who gives with the motive of being seen by others. A hypocrite defined in the Greek was a Greek actor who wore a mask. It was anyone pretending to be who they were not. Right now, we're in our presidential elections. Yeah, I knew y'all liked this one. Got two candidates. One of the biggest issues in many people's lives is, who's wearing the mask? Who is it that really just simply wants to get elected and just trying to find the right words, but absolutely has no change of heart, absolutely does not have a right motive, you and I are going to have to make some choices here in the next 30, 40 days about who we feel is not the pretender. Because ultimately, a pretender will never have your best interest at heart. But it's like what the Bible says, the false prophet comes to you. It's a wolf inwardly, but he knows if it's a wolf, you're going to run. So what the wolf must do is put itself in sheep's clothing. It must appear innocent. It must appear that it can't do you no harm, but inwardly. And this is why motives, again, are so critical, because they reflect the real person. Let me tell you something. You can only pretend so long. As I said, the Greek actors, they wore a mask. Now, everyone can see this is an Obama mask. I started to get the one that got the big ears because I have little ears, so that have been a real giveaway. Me putting on this mask, and those watching on television, my pretending to be him does not make me. As a matter of fact, the real deal here is that ultimately, pretenders don't fool anybody. Ultimately, you can tell a person for who they are. And this is another reason I say to those you are dating, male and female, you need to get to know that person before you get engaged or get married. Don't be coming to me talking about is love at first sight. Somebody said, but I believe in puppy love. Well, that's okay, but sometimes it ends up with a dog's life. So, brothers and sisters, ultimately, the pretender fools no one, especially Jesus, who knew what was in the hearts of men. Note verses 2-4. He says, when you give to the needy, don't announce it with trumpets as the hypocrites do in the synagogues on the streets, to be honored by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you give to the needy, don't let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will what? Jesus quickly moves from hypocrisy in giving to hypocrisy in prayer. Note verse 5. And when you pray, don't be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on street corners to what? Be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. Now, let's be clear, because it's easy to get a wrong view of this. It's easy to say, well, you know, then we should never have public giving and all of that because, you know, what about our motives? Every fourth Sunday, we walk for the United and Victory Capital campaign. I want you to make a delineation that is critical to this text. It's not the giving or praying in public that's the problem. That's not the problem. It's the hypocrite's purpose to obtain praise for themselves and not God. That's the problem. You're going to catch this. That person who was giving made sure they got to a street corner where everybody could see them, where all the crowds were gathered to make sure everyone saw what a giving person they were. It had nothing to do with it being in public. It had to do with for him to, or her to get what they want. It was important for them to get the praise from men. Even in our prayers, ladies and gentlemen, I want you to know what the Bible says in Matthew 5 and 16. Otherwise, we have a contradiction here. Jesus, the same Jesus, said, in the same way, let your light shine before others that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. That appears to be a blatant contradiction. But it is not a contradiction. God wants your light to shine before others. What God wants to also occur that when your light shine, that your Father in heaven gets the glory and not you. That's the point. He wants your light to shine bright, that you love God, that you give in kingdom building, that you are a prayer warrior. But he wants the glory not to come to you. He wants the glory to go to him. If your goal is to please men, Jesus says, you receive your reward in what? Got a question for you. You see this bill here, it says what? Paid in full. Nobody owes any more money on a debt that's been paid in full. So I ask you a question, and those you shared on television. If everything you've done has been for the wrong motives in serving God, if everything you've done has been to get paid, then does God owe you anything? Think about it now. We say we are storing up treasure in heaven where neither moth nor rust does corrupt, nor where thieves break in to steal. But how can we have treasure in heaven if we've been paid in full on earth? Some of y'all not thinking about it. This is the reason for me as a pastor. The board will tell you there are many things I do that takes hours and hours, not on my job description, have absolutely nothing to do with me getting paid a dime, because I want to make sure that I'm going to store up some treasure in heaven. And we need volunteers in the church ready to give of their time, their talents, their tithes, because they realize this is a work that is so great, so awesome, this gospel, that we have to get it out and whatever they can do. And plus, you should always be able to look back and say, you know what, if I don't get paid a dime, God's been good to me. God has blessed me. God has blessed my family. It's an honor to give anything back to God. You see, ladies and gentlemen, the Lord wants the believer to have right motives. Note again, verses 6 through 8 says, but when you pray, you go in your room. You close the door. You pray to your Father who is unseen, your Father who sees what is done in secret. He's going to reward you. In other words, and don't keep on babbling, just thinking that because you're running your mouth for the next 30 minutes that God is pleased. You done said, God doesn't have a learning disability. You don't have to keep saying the same thing over and over and over again. Don't be like him. For your Father knows what you need before you ask him. He says, shut the door. Every believer, and those you share it on television, to ask you, do you have a personal, private place to pray? Just stop and think about it. You see, to shut the door is to shut out everything that is going on so you can focus on your relationship with your God. Going to help somebody right now. See, some of you in your marriage, one of the reasons that you're having so many problems in your marriage, you don't have time for the most fundamental of relationships in a marriage. Well, what is that? The relationship between a husband and his wife. It's about the kids. It's about the job. It's about, I got to take care of this person. I take care of that person. Do you not realize that the first person in your life besides God is your husband or your wife? And the next thing you know, you begin to drift apart and you still doing all that other stuff, but you haven't focused on the husband and the wife. That's all right. I'm going to get me some help. To some of you here today and sharing on television, I ask you this question. Is the lack of a prayer life the reason you fail so often in your spiritual tests? Is the reason you fail so often is because you are not prayed up. But brothers and sisters, with all the issues facing us, our families, our community, our nation, the words from 2 Chronicles 7 in your responsive reading come to bear. As Lord appears to King Solomon, the dedication of the great Solomonic temple, the people had been sinning. But the Lord said, I've heard your prayer. I've chosen this place for myself as a temple for sacrifices. When I shut up the heavens, there's no rain, or command locusts to devour the land, or send a plague among my people. Bad things happening because of sin by God's people. But he said, but if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, I will hear from heaven. I'll forgive their sin and I will what? I'll heal the land. The Bible says the believer is to pray without ceasing. All right, Pastor, I agree. I need to pray more. You made that clear. But how do I pray? First of all, you need to be taught if you're a baby saint. The second, how should I pray, is Jesus' answer. He gives it right in Matthew 6, verses 9 to 16. Excuse me, 9 to 13. When you get alone with God, this is how you pray to God. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we have also forgiven our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. This is a model prayer. It gives us the elements of effective prayer. It's not telling us we have to quote it verbatim. Well, what's necessary for your prayers to be effective? When you get along with God, you learn how to get along with God. You see, effective prayer life is based on relationships. And sometimes you need to get along with the one you love. Most days, just sharing my own personal life, most days, I literally wait till my wife and my daughter and granddaughter for them to go off to work or school. Then I get along with God. But what I have noticed in my 38 years of walking with God, you would think, and I know some prayer people are going to help me with this, you would think I'd be tired of praying. I done prayed every prayer possible in 38 years every day. But what is it about our God that we long to be alone with him? That the relationship is so strong, so intimate, that our day doesn't seem to start right unless we can get alone with him. The reason you are so excited, those of you that are like that, is because Jesus has become the lover of your soul. He gives you what nobody else can give you. He makes you feel like nobody else can make you feel. You feel this close, deep, personal relationship, and you want to be alone so you can get along with your God. Give him some praise up in here. And let me be clear. The first thing you do and foremost when you get alone, first thing, for those of you taking notes, you need to do a little writing. Your prayer, according to Jesus here, should bring glory to God. That is first and foremost. Because first of all, we worship him for who he is. There should be a sense of awe and reverence as you and I come into the presence of the living God. And we have lost that in our society. Think of the number of words with God in it that end with profanity that some of you have used and recently. Think of how low we think about God. This is God. This, you're not talking to your homie. This ain't your boy. This is God Almighty who spoke the universe into existence. This is God who fills all time and space, and you just feel this little bit of space right here. This is God who is eternal, and you just got to start a few years ago. This is God who is immortal, and you and I have beginning and end. This is God who is spirit, and you are flesh. This is God who is holy, and you and I are sinners. How can we not fall down before him with reverence and with awe? Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. That's where real believers get to, that kind of place. with their God. And the second thing they say is, you know your prayer is effective when you begin to understand that what he wants for his kingdom is bigger than you. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. When you advance his kingdom with your time, with your talents, with your tithing, with your giving, it's showing that your prayer is effective because you understand nothing is more important on this earth than doing what God wants to be done. And as I close, those you shared on television, the testimony in Scripture, and those gathered here today, is that prayer works. No, I'm going to deal with it. As King Hezekiah, who told him, get yourself ready, you're about to die, he prayed. The Lord added 15 years to his life. Now, here somebody say, that was thousands of years ago. Well, today we begin, on First Sunday, we're celebrating the beginning of Breast Cancer Awareness Month. I want every woman in here that had it, if you don't have no shame about it, to say, yeah, I had it, but I prayed and my God healed me. Wherever you are, where you're staying, or any sister that's gone through, look here, look here, look around, look around, look around, look around. Get that camera, get it, look around you. How many of you know he's a healer? There's nothing too hard for God, but you got to pray. Give him some praise up in this house. As Daniel, if prayer works, thrown into a lion's den by his enemies who did him wrong, but Daniel prayed. He was delivered, and hungry lions didn't eat him, but they ate up his enemies a few hours later. As Peter in jail, as we wrap this up, the church prayed in Acts, the 12th chapter. The angel freed him. He goes to the house of Mary, the mother of John. He gets there. He knocks on the door. A servant girl named Rhoda runs to the door, looks, and sees Peter. She's freaking out because they are praying for Peter even as he was knocking on the door. She doesn't even open the door. Peter's knocking. She takes off to tell everybody that Peter's at the door. And I know Peter's going, now, wait a minute, wait a minute. I have been told if you ask, you'll receive. I have been told if you seek, you'll find. I heard that if I knock, the door would be open, but the door is still closed. She goes back and said, Peter at the door. They say it must be his ghost. Let me tell you this as we end this message. Don't pray for nothing if you don't believe God can do it. Prayer's a waste of time if you don't believe God is able. Prayer's a waste of time if you don't believe he's able to do exceeding and abundantly above all that you can ask or even think. How many of you in front of me now know God has done the things you didn't even dream was possible? Well, why? Because he's God and you're not. Give him praise up in this house. Hallelujah. And as I end this message, I know somebody is going, well, every prayer didn't get answered the way I want. All right, let's deal with that. I got an answer for you. I prayed for my relative, they died. I asked for that job, I didn't get it. Well, I got an answer. I ain't gonna duck it. It's found in 1 John 5:14-15. This is the confidence we have in approaching God. If we first of all ask anything according to his will, we know that he hears us. If we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know we have what we have, what? Desired of him. What I want you to understand is this. Everything, they didn't put the next verse up there? Wait a minute. They got it right. What I want you to be clear of is that everything you ask God for is about his will. If we ask anything according to his will, You shouldn't want anything that God doesn't want for you. Like a parent shouldn't want, a child shouldn't want anything that a loving parent won't give to their child. And I know as I end this message, millions praying to God. Same time. Say, how does he hear my prayer? Two answers, and then we open the doors of the church. First of all, the scripture says, the eyes of the Lord are in every place. The Bible says his eyes are over the righteous and his ears are open to their prayer. And I knew I would get this reaction. So let me give you my final one, and then I'm going to open up the doors of the church. I have been to, like some of you, many, many children birthday parties. Come on, how many of you got kids or had little kids and you got to go to these parties? This is why grandparenting is so great. And I've been in room just watching. There'll be 8 to 10 mothers. There are 30 kids in that room, jumping, moving, all enough to send you to Tylenol land. All those kids, I watch a mother talking to another mother. Then all of a sudden, there's a cry in the background. 30 kids. All them kids. But the one cry moves that mother to action. All the other kids, they could be crying and jumping and doing, but this one cry moves the mother to action. Let me tell you why. Because that one's hers. Because you see, when you belong to God and he is your heavenly father, it don't matter if there are billions of prayers. God hears your prayer. He reaches out to you. He hears your cry because you are his child. Now give him some praise if you are a child of God. Give him some praise if you know he hears your prayer.
Thank you for joining us today. And we look forward to worshiping with you at either our 9 a.m. or 11:30 a.m. Sunday services that are biblically based, illustrated, contemporary, and timely. Our services cater to men, women, the young, and young at heart. We also invite you to join us for Tuesday night Bible study at 7:45 p.m. and lunch on the Word on Wednesdays at noon. We are so thankful for your continued support of this ministry. And if this excerpt from our service touched your heart to either give financially to the ministry or to purchase the entire worship service on either CD or DVD, please call 708-283-0383 or visit us online at www.victoryapostolicchurch.org.